Mae'n noswaith dda, bawb. Y croeso cynnes iawn i chi i gyd i ein Dalith ar-lein ar gyfer y Wyl Archeoleg. Heno, fydd Dwyrain Whiteright yn trafod archeoleg ach arforol Cymru o longau drylliedig i dirweddau sydd dan y dŵr. A very warm welcome to you all tonight for our Festival of Archaeology online lecture. Tonight, Dwyrain Whiteright will be talking about the maritime archaeology of Wales, from shipwrecks to submerged landscape. Before we start, a bit of housekeeping. You're welcome to ask any questions, and Dwyrain will be happy to answer them after the talk. Could you please write your questions in the question and answer function? We would be grateful if you don't use the chat for questions. Thanks. And this evening's talk will be recorded and shared on other platforms. For those not watching this live, you are also welcome to send us any questions or share your comments, and Dwyrain will reply to them as soon as possible. Be the scores hon drwy rhwng y Saesneg heno, cofiwch fod croeso i chi gysylltu â ni yn y Gymraeg os ydych chi'n am ofyn cwestiwn neu adael sylw. Hoffwn nawr gyflwyno ein siaradwr heno, sef Dwyrain Whiteright. Dwyrain, yw archeolegydd mor o rôl y Comisiwn Brenhinol gyda chyfrifoldeb am safleoedd archeolegol o dan y Marc Penllanw ac am beth un yn union ar y Marc Penllanw. Cafodd ei fagu a lan y môr yn Sir Benfro ac mae wedi gweithio fel archeolegydd morol ers 2001. Ymunodd Dwyrain a'r Comisiwn Brenhinol 2 flynedd yn ôl ar ôl gweithio yn sectorau masnachol a academaidd yn y Deyrnas Unedig. Dwyrain is the maritime archaeologist at the Royal Commission and has responsibility for archaeological sites below the high water mark and a few directly on the high water mark. He grew up by the sea in Pembrokeshire and has worked as a maritime archaeologist since 2001. Dwyrain joined the commission 2 years ago, having previously worked in the commercial and academic sectors of UK maritime archaeology. Felly, ar hynny o eiria, drosodd I Dwyrain.
Thank you very much, Dave. Right, good evening, everybody. It's lovely to see so many people here. And lovely to see quite a few names on the list that I haven't met or seen for quite a long time since before COVID. So yeah, hello to everybody. What I'm going to try and do this evening, start my stopwatch in an effort to not massively overrun, is to introduce you to some of the maritime archaeological sites around Wales, particularly some in Pembrokeshire near where I live, not at all biased. But to just give a flavour of what there is around the Welsh coast for people who are not familiar with it. And also in doing that, to try to sort of explain what the Royal Commission does from a maritime archaeological standpoint, how our work maybe meshes into other things, what our extent and remit and so on actually is within that. So what I'm going to look to do today is briefly sort of outline, flesh out what maritime archaeology even is, because I realise that some people probably don't know or think it's something different. The types of archaeological sites that we have, how we do maritime archaeology, which isn't really very much different from normal archaeology, to be honest. Then think a little bit about the commission, where maritime fits in to the Royal Commission's work, and particularly the National Monuments Record, our marine planning remit, and then just sort of summarise a little bit of recent work that has been done in the last 9 months to a year on a few of the sort of the main site types, submerged forests, harbours, shipwrecks, and think about what all that means really. And I'm very conscious I've left my original kind of blurb that I wrote on the screen here just to sort of remind myself to try not to ramble on. I'd be probably quite happy to talk all night, to be honest, but I realised, you know, people have got things to do. My children will probably invade us at some point. So I need to try and retain a little bit of focus with everything. So firstly, to maritime archaeology, which I think inevitably people associate shipwrecks and the word shipwrecks. And the commonest question I get when I say what I do for a job and what I've always done for a job is, well, you must go diving on shipwrecks. I used to quite a long time ago. I don't really do that anymore. I mainly find to be found on beaches and the edge of the coast, I suppose. But I think this document from CADU, which is available online from CADU's website, Managing the Marine Historic Environment of Wales, a snappy title, really gets to grips with how maritime archaeology is perceived in the 21st century, which, yeah, shipwrecks are an important part of it. But, and particularly within Wales, we have this amazing record of submerged landscapes and intertidal landscapes, the lands that are now lost beneath the sea, which we know from myth and legend, but are also an archaeological reality, even down to the footprints that people once left in these areas. But also the sort of infrastructure and settlement from more recent times, coastal sites, harbours, crashed aeroplanes, you know, you name it, and it is somewhere within the maritime sphere. So really what we're concerned with as maritime archaeologists is basically everything to do with people and the sea, but not just the sea, although the word maritime is really bound up in thinking about the sea. It's also rivers and lakes and all of these things. And as a discipline, we've kind of just settled on the word maritime because we all kind of know what we mean, and hopefully everybody else does. And we don't have to have long, dull arguments about what to call ourselves, which is what we used to do as a discipline. And some of this has, you know, real penetration into the inland areas of Wales. You think of some of our tidal rivers that extend miles and miles and miles inland. And that is all sort of ways for people to reach the interior on ships and boats, both, you know, many, many thousands of years ago and in recent decades. Types of sites that we might find. I suppose lots of the things on this little schematic drawing are fairly obvious. Shipwrecks, crashed aeroplanes, things on offshore islands, lighthouses, and then in the intertidal zone between the high tide mark and the low tide mark, more shipwrecks. We do have plenty of those. Harbours, lime kilns, coastal sites, submerged forests, all of these types of things are what we kind of find. And to put some images to those, you know, all around the Welsh coast, we have things like, yeah, the wonderful sort of historic harbours like Tenby pictured on the screen. This is a fish trapper, Poppet Sands, Dinas Tinthley coastal fort, crashed aeroplane site off Harlech. Some of the very, very deep water sites that have been mapped incredibly effectively by Bangor University. So there's a real kind of richness and breadth to the maritime archaeological sites around the Welsh coast. How we investigate those is really, in terms of the work of the Commission, probably best illustrated through this diagram, which was commissioned for the Cherish project, which I'm sure many of you have heard of. If you haven't, then the website on the screen there is really well worth a look. And this is a long-running project that the Commission leads on between ourselves and Aberystwyth University and partners in Ireland to map and record and understand the coastal cultural heritage of reefs, islands and shorelines. I think that's the acronym. I always get it slightly wrong though. But really to do that with a reference to climate change and coastal change and understanding the impact of those things on the heritage. And as it moves towards the end of the project, to produce guidance to allow other people and other groups to sort of map and monitor and understand things. And all of our sort of toolbox, if you like, that we can sort of throw at these sites is kind of visualized on the screen here. Now, some of this is kind of specific to, you know, shipwreck sites, offshore, underwater, diving on sites, marine geophysical survey, for example. But almost everything else on here, in terms of numbers 1 to 10, is kind of just mainstream archaeology, really. LIDAR, the use of drones, excavation on here somewhere, geophysical survey, coring, laser scanning, GPS, satellite imagery. I've never had to abseil down a cliff for work, I have to say. Maybe that's coming up in the future at some point, but so far I've avoided that. So really the maritime archaeological sites, you know, all of these things are there to allow us to get to the sites, to understand the sites, to map them, to survey and investigate them. And we don't always have to, you know, use everything on every site, but this is the sort of the full extent of the things that we have available to us. And I think it's important to emphasize really that you know, maritime archaeology is not a special type of archaeology. It's just archaeology. Some of it's underwater, some of it's not. None of it's, pretty much none of it's up a mountain. That makes things a bit easier. So it's we're just doing archaeology with the normal tools and ways of thinking that people apply to regular archaeological sites. In terms then of the Royal Commission and the remit of maritime archaeology within that, what my role really entails is about contributing to and enhancing the maritime element of the National Monuments Record of Wales, the NMRW. So this is the reason that the commission exists, if you like, to compile and maintain this overall list of all of the monuments to the, I think it's something like the history, civilization and culture of Wales from the earliest time to the present, pretty much. And this has many, many, many sites on it that are not given statutory protection. So they're not designated or listed or scheduled. And my element of that is that, you know, the specifically the maritime part of it. So as an illustration on the screen there, there is the remains of a tugboat. An important part of maritime goings on, servicing vessels, but these ones are not particularly old. They were lost in St. Bride's Bay near Solway in 1981. But actually, they form a way for us to understand site formation processes of more recent vessels. And these ones are 40 years old. There's other ones that are 50, 60, 70, 80 years old. And at some point, these will become, you know, historically relevant because of their age, if they aren't all already like that. So there's probably some of the more recent things in the maritime part of the National Monuments Record. And maintaining that then takes us into the other bit, which is fulfilling the Royal Commission's role as a statutory consultee for marine licensing within Wales. And I'll come on to that in a little while. And then things like tonight's talk, dissemination of our work and the material that we gather, the public engagement element, and then also attempting to, I suppose, continuously develop new, better, improved ways to do what we do, to deploy new survey techniques to allow us to work quicker or more accurately or more efficiently. So in terms then of those records themselves, I'm happy to say and report that Wales has far more sea than it does land. In terms of its sea area, which is the red dotted line on the map here, which goes all the way out to the middle of St. George's Channel, the Celtic Sea and the Irish Sea, where it meets Irish sea, if you like, to the west, a bit of the Isle of Man, some of the northwest of England sea area, and then down to the southern sort of Bristol Channel shore, is around 32,000 kilometres, as opposed to the 21,000 square kilometres of land. And the Welsh coast is, you know, just over 2,500 kilometres long, which includes plenty of coast that is not served by the Wales coast path. So if you're all frantically Googling how long is the coast of Wales, it's a really difficult answer to come up with. Depends on what you read, I suppose. So the National Monuments Record of Wales is 120,000 sites, I think it is, roughly, of which about just over 8,000 of those are below or beyond the high water mark. Some of them are kind of back up above the high water mark, but they're, you know, 20 miles offshore or something. So they still sort of sit within the maritime remit. Those sites, to switch to the map on the right of your screen, which is all the sort of dots on the map, split down into a few of the sort of the main types. There are a lot of shipwrecks, you know, without beating around the bush. There's sort of 5,500 documented wreck losses, which we certainly don't know where they all are. Many of them have been lost and never found. There's just over 1,000 that are with a sort of a confirmed location. There's plenty of aircraft crash sites in the blue dots, fish traps along the coastline, anchorages, lighthouses, the submerged forests I've talked a little bit about, we'll come on to in a bit. More ephemeral things you don't really think of as being in the National Monuments Record, stepping stones. There's a few sea mines from the Second World War dotted around the coast that have been recorded and added in. So it's a very comprehensive sort of set of material. It also contains places that are really, in some senses, quite hard to actually put a dot on the map. anchorages? Where do you define the edge of an anchorage? Where does a landing place sort of start and finish? But these are all really important points for understanding lots of the other archaeological material. So there's a lime kiln on the screen. For those people who don't know what one of these is, this is a structure that would have had a large hole in the top. And at some point in the 19th and early 20th century, a ship would have beached down here, unloaded a cargo of limestone and coal, which would have, the limestone would have gone in the top, along with some of the coal. You light a fire on the side here. There's another one over here. You burn the limestone down, and that is then spread on the fields to improve the agricultural fertility of the soil. And these are dotted all along the Ceredigionshire coast and the Pembrokeshire coast in particular. They're also, you know, pretty much uniformly, bar one or two, above the high water mark. So are they maritime in nature? They're completely linked to the sea in terms of their use and their, you know, interaction with the fuel and everything that comes into them. So we have to kind of look at them in that sense to be able to understand them properly. So there's a whole host of these kind of sites which are above the high water mark, but very much fall into the, you know, the maritime remit, as well as all of Wales's historic harbours, landing places, the infrastructure of those, quays, wharfs, jetties, and so on. So they're all part of this kind of the maritime view of things. Being able to compile that National Monuments record in that way is really, really critical for one of the other facets of what the Commission does, which is the marine planning element of things. So just in the same way that you have to submit a planning application if you want to build a house or develop a road or, you know, that kind of thing, you have to do the same thing at sea. So you have to have a marine license as part of the Marine and Coastal Access Act, which was passed in the UK in 2009. And this is governed by something called the Welsh National Marine Plan. And part of that is this policy society number 5, which covers historic assets, which is the not very attractive name given to, you know, archaeological and historical things. So in doing that, if somebody says they want to, for example, build a wind farm like the one on the screen, they have to take into account many, many, many factors, which includes marine biology, environmental things, what the thing looks like, but also the archaeology that it might impact through, you know, driving a wind farm turbine pile through the middle of a shipwreck. Not a good thing for anybody, the shipwreck or the machinery involved. And in that case, you would probably do it somewhere else, avoid the impact, or you might be able to minimize it in some way, or in some cases, it's actually unavoidable to impact on the historic assets that are there. There are only some places that some things like pipes and cables and railway lines and bridges can actually go. So in that case, we would resort to something called preservation by record, where we set out to record the archaeological material in such a way that even though its physical remains might be lost, we still have our record of it for you know, the future, if you like. And the Commission's role is really important in this, because it's the only sort of organisation within the Welsh heritage sector and the Welsh archaeological sector that has a maritime specific post. The CADW doesn't have one, and the Welsh Archaeological Trust don't have one. So the Commission holds this sort of body of expertise and experience within that. So as kind of a summary of some of the things we've dealt with in the last year are on the screen. So this is the year ending April 2022. Quite a spread of things around Wales. Lots of these dots on the north coast are to do with coastal defence work, which is being replaced and upgraded along the North Wales coast. But it includes the things that spring to mind immediately, like maybe offshore cables, wind farms. There's quite a lot of quite low level things like aquaculture, seabed sampling to understand marine biology better. There's a few railway bridges being built and renovated on here, some harbour dredging, you know, these kind of things. So quite a full suite of material that we get consulted on to ensure that the maritime archaeology is taken into consideration within the planning system. And those sites, as you can see on the map, are really densely located around two of the sort of historic anchorages, if you like, and port sites within Wales, Holyhead in the north and Milford Haven in the south, and the Milford Haven waterway, with further kind of concentrations, Cardiff, Barry, And then Swansea sort of neath the Talbot kind of direction, a little bit around Bangor and Carnarvon and off the mouth of the Dee Estuary. There's a general concentration on the coast, as you might expect, because people understand and know where stuff is better when it's, you know, a ship is wrecked on the coast or something turns up on a beach. And then there is a, you know, a scattering, a fairly steady scattering of mostly shipwrecks and a few aeroplanes in the offshore zone. And there's not really very much in Cardigan Bay, which is not because there's nothing in Cardigan Bay. It's just never really been surveyed terribly well because there hasn't been a need to survey it terribly well. In the future, that might change. It might be possible to proactively go out and complete one of the sort of the holes in our record, if you like. And I mean, the commission's remit for the survey side of it does not entail at the moment anyway, going out and undertaking large scale marine geophysical surveys to map the seafloor specifically to look for shipwrecks. But lots of this work does happen in advance to marine planning. So if somebody's building a wind farm or laying a cable, the seabed is mapped in a lot of detail in advance of that, primarily from a self-interest point of view to ensure that somebody doesn't destroy their dredging equipment or cable laying equipment on a shipwreck. But also with that marine planning in mind as a means to ensure that you can avoid the stuff in the first place, which is the kind of the first key part of policy number five. The box on here is where we are going next to take a small snippet of the Welsh coast, a bit of the north coast of Pembrokeshire and a little bit of the west coast of Pembrokeshire, to really kind of get across, I guess, just the richness and some of the diversity of the types of site. And really, although I'm probably a bit biased in including things from Pembrokeshire, you could take these sites and pick any, you know, 10 kilometer stretch of coast around Wales, and you would probably find, you know, similar sets of material of a similar quality and of a similar level of, you know, interest with compelling historical stories and associations and so on. So this is just a little snapshot to sketch out what it is all around the Welsh coast. So firstly, to think about submerged forest. Now, the image on the screen is not the Pembrokeshire coast. I'm sure some of you recognize that this is Tawyn. And this is what we, you know, often think about as being the archetypal image of a submerged forest, a tree stump, a petrified tree stump sticking up out of the sand, maybe another one up here in the distance, but this kind of thing, something that is obviously a tree. And Wales is really, really blessed as a country with this as an archaeological resource all around the Welsh coast, from the Gwent levels down in the southeast to the furthest west part of Pembrokeshire, White Sands, all the way up to the north coast and Rhyl and Point of Ayre. You can find remnants of the landscapes that used to be trees and forests and grasslands and everything, which have become submerged as sea level has risen since the last ice age. End of the last ice age, sea level was something like 120 meters lower than it is today. So huge tracts of the area around Wales were land. And over time, that has become inundated, vegetation has turned into peat, tree stumps have become preserved. And much of this dates to the sort of, I'll probably get the dates wrong now, there's probably an expert watching. It's sort of in the 6,000, the earliest ones, through to the 3,000, maybe 2,500 BC. So from what we would term as the Mesolithic period through the transition into the Neolithic, when people start adopting agriculture, and then on into the sort of the early Bronze Age period. And what that hints at as well in thinking about those things is something that we term paleolandscapes and submerged paleolandscapes. And these are the remains of those very, very ancient lands that have become submerged. And really excellent projects such as the West Coast Paleolandscape Project, echoing some of the work that you might have heard about, sort of Doggerland and things like that in the North Sea, have set out using data, marine geophysical survey data and geotechnical data, to reconstruct and understand the landscapes on the west coast of Britain and Wales in particular. So this is a snapshot of the Bristol Channel. But not just to sort of sit here as I am and going, well, there was land there at some point and people probably lived there, but to map it in detail, understand where the rivers flows, where the lakes might have been, where the places that people might have gathered, and so on, so that in the future we might be able to begin to predict where some of those archaeological sites that would have been lowland sites at the time might possibly have been. And it's not just in the 20th century and into the 21st century that people have commented on these lost lands. We know about the sort of them from myth and legend, particularly in Cardigan Bay, but also in the, you know, Gerald of Wales in the 12th century is writing and recounting the stories he was told as he was traveling through Pembrokeshire past Newgale about the appearance of the submerged forest there. And I think it's this historical depth actually to the forest at Newgale which makes it one of the more famous ones, even though it's extremely difficult to see it most of the time and it's not visible. Whereas if you go to, sorry, there's a child shouting in the background, if you go to somewhere like Borth on the Ceredigion coast, that forest there is exposed in a huge extent much of the time. But Gerald of Wales recounts this sort of event after a big storm where the sand is stripped away and these old trees appear, the strokes of the hatchet appearing as if made only yesterday. And it looked like somebody had literally come and cut down a woodland and left it in the sea. Now, at Newgale, it's possible sometimes to find this, not quite in the manner of Gerald's description of it, but this is in October and November of last year, when at the end of September, there was some kind of, you know, weather event, not a big storm by any stretch of the imagination, that caused the sediment on this beach to quite dramatically move, exposing a huge load of sort of boulder layers up the centre of the beach, which is interspersed with really, really big peat deposits. And as we'll see in a second, some of those trees that maybe Gerald of Wales was talking about from 800 years ago. But it also demonstrates Newgale since then, this sort of expanse of submerged forest became covered over within a couple of months. So by December, this was completely infilled with about maybe half a metre of sand, a metre of sand. And despite the severe storms that happened at the end of December and again in the spring, which some of, I'm sure people can remember the strengths of the winds and the waves and everything, the sand on this beach didn't really move at all, despite expectations that level of storminess would have stripped the sand away and exposed these things again, as it did back in 2014. And it really served to highlight one of the challenges to our work, that predicting when sites would become exposed is really, really difficult. And monitoring sites by just going, well, I'll just visit it once a year. You can do that, and I've done it. And you turn up and everything is buried, you know, and you see the top of a few timbers of a shipwreck or the odd bit of peat. So it's very much what we need, and I'll get on to this a bit later, is the sort of the ability of people to be prepared to say, well, I walk on this beach every day as these people are here, and it has changed and stuff has appeared that I've never seen before. I don't really know what it is, but it kind of looks like archaeology. So, you know, and to get in touch and say that. Anyway, further up the beach is this marvellous timber tree trunk, which is, you know, really is like one of Gerald of Wales' trees that have just been felled. So this is a 5.5 metre length of tree. We've managed to take a couple of samples just from this end of it, of some of the peat and a small branch. I didn't quite feel up to sawing a lump off this tree, although with hindsight, because I haven't seen it since because it's remained buried, I kind of wish I had. Because the submerged forest at Newgale has never been dated. Lots of the other forests all around Wales have been assigned a date, either through dendrochronology or through carbon 14 dating, but Newgale hasn't. So it was really great to be able to get a sample, to have it dated for this beach, and to have that coming back just around sort of 4000 BC or so, which very much fits with, you know, the bulk of the rest of what we know. The way in which we can now record this material quite rapidly using photography and then photogrammetry to create a 3D model of things means that it's also very, very easy to share things. So there's a couple of links on the screen that are going to be forwarded to you in an email, probably in a day or so after the talk, that you can follow. And you can sort of inspect this tree trunk to your heart's content, down to the last grain of sand, explore some of the annotation on there, along with quite a few of the other sites that I'm going to mention today. So that's, you know, worth keep an eye out in your inboxes for that, for that follow-up email. But also, that at the same time that that material on Newgale was growing, and then it was developing, and then it was going to be inundated, and then eventually become the sort of the petrified forest that we know today, other things were happening, or that we know were happening, in a sort of the wider world that links the Welsh coast and the archaeological sites that we know about from prehistory around the Welsh coast. And this is the huge amount of maritime traffic in prehistory that was traveling up and down the Irish Sea, an area that has been termed by people like Barry Cunliffe and Fraser Sturt and people long before them as the Western Seaways of Britain. And we know that there were linkages between the Orkneys and the Hebrides and the Irish coast and the Welsh coast and the Cornish coast and the French coast, you know, and right the way down the Atlantic seaboard in the Neolithic period, the Bronze Age, the Iron Age, you know, the periods before the Romans turned up and started saying, you know, well, we did this and we know about these people over here and so on. And it's significant because all of these journeys, be they hopping around the coast or coming to Pembrokeshire and then across to Ireland and up the more sheltered Irish side, all of them have to travel through these two sort of points of constriction. And particularly this one I see as sort of the gateway to the central area, if you like. And it allows us to think a little bit about some of the big prehistoric promontory forts that we have at places like the Deer Park, near Marlowe's and St. David's Head, White Sands Bay, Porthmerow, and places like this as being quite central to actually to understanding the regime of the tides and the navigation, everything around these headlands, to unpicking how people traveled up and down these things. And most of the work has been done on sort of long distance travel, I suppose, and understanding the feasibility of a voyage from France to the Hebrides. But I'm sure that future research would be able to start to look at sort of the micro scale, if you like, of what's happening and the movement around these areas. And that kind of leads us sort of neatly into what do people do when they get to the land, they've been on these voyages. And it takes us back to all of the harbours and the bays and the anchorages and so on. And this is a site on the Thleen Peninsula, Morfa Nebyn. You have the modern breakwater from one of Toby Driver's aerial photos in our archive. And then further out, somewhat forgotten, is the old breakwater, if you like, now in a state of disrepair. Now, both of these are in the National Monuments Record. And this one, we probably need to go and do a little bit more work on to sort of record it now that we can record it in sort of three-dimensional digital detail. And to give you an example of the sort of the ongoing work on sites like this and the value of both on the one hand, the aerial photography and the sort of the ability to put together historical and archaeological detail is this site at Fishguard in Pembrokeshire. So this is Lower Town Fishguard on the left-hand side. This is the sort of the typical, picture postcard aerial view. It's a beautiful little harbour, old warehousing along one side and cottages. Some of the warehouses now turned into housing. Another one up here, the mouth of the River Gwine, an old quay down here. There's an old fort, now disused from the Napoleonic period, up on Castle Point, which with a single shot repelled the French invasion of 1797, or at least convinced them not to land here, but to go around the corner a bit prior to their defeat. And in last autumn, I was kind of going through some aerial photos that were taken back in 2010 during one of Toby's aerial reconnaissance flights. And it's worth noting that we're really lucky that the commission is able to do that, because that aerial photography is the kind of the baseline record of so many of our sites, and is a sort of a fixed record that we can go back to and review over time. I think probably just to look up something to do with the fort, and I kind of noticed that I'd been up there a number of times, but I think usually the tide was in. Toby's photos here targeted at the beach, so the tide is out, and there is a thing on the beach here, you know, a pile of rocks that is quite different from all of these other piles of rocks down here and looks a bit more man-made, not a natural kind of feature. So you could look at the same site from a different angle. You have to imagine Toby now in the plane doing a nice, beautiful spiral over the fort as he's busily snapping pictures. And we can see that something definitely looks like this is maybe a quay that is underneath the old fort at Castle Point. We're also really lucky in our ability to mesh together the historical sources on one hand with the archaeological material. And it's really important in, I think, all branches of certainly post-medieval archaeology and medieval archaeology, that we actually look at both of those things as equal kind of pieces of source material and don't only look at the archaeology or only look at the historical material. And this kind of describes why that's useful to do. So we have a wonderful set of maps, marine maps, charts from the 18th century that were produced by somebody called Lewis Morris, who was a hydrographer, self-taught hydrographer from Anglesey, and who mapped in real sort of accuracy for the time, the Welsh coast at large scale, and then also detail of individual, the important ports and harbours and roadsteads. And his set of charts was published in 1748. So it gives us a snapshot. He was working up to that point. So it gives us this snapshot of, the decade or so before 1748 in terms of what was where. His son continued that work and extended it around the south coast of Wales, updated the chart. So that chart on the wall behind me is William Morris's chart of 1800 of the whole of the Welsh coast. And you can see some of the features on here. So there's a weir, fish weir down at Goodwick, more of that in a little while. And then if we zoom in on Lower Town Fish Guard, you can see the old quay that is there now, and the anchorage is marked on it, some of the houses. And out here under Penny Castle, Castle Head, is a pier and an anchorage. So there's a direct correlation between the historical material and the physical remains on the ground. And the material on the ground, this thing down here, was not in the National Monuments Record. It wasn't in the local historic environment records. It wasn't in any of CADU's list. So it was a site that, for some reason, despite the fact it's not hiding, it's not a new discovery. We've just sort of been through a process of re-looking at things and identified it, had the time to do a tiny bit of digging, probably about 20 minutes, to mesh together the historical material and the archaeological material. What took longer was finding a tidal window when I didn't have a more important site to go and look at to actually get there to be able to look at it. To sort of just check that, yeah, this was indeed an old quay. And bearing in mind that the historical evidence for this is pointing that this is there, certainly in the early 18th century, early 1700s. So this is probably a 300-year-old quay. Now, if somebody found a 300-year-old house in a field that they'd never really, nobody'd ever really realised the date of it before, it would probably get listed immediately. So I've got a phone call to CADU on this one. And then once we get overhead through dint of a small drone, basically to take low-level aerial shots, you can begin to pick out some of the details. So there's a quite a distinctive edge there, a line of what we term headers. So these are the ones laid with the head of the dressed stone outwards, a rubble infill. It's likely that quite a lot of this has been robbed over the years and reused in other places. And I guess our next thing is to go and record this in a little bit more detail to understand the construction of it properly, and to try and really understand the relationship of it to the fort. Because the other thing is that Lewis Morris chart of 1748 shows something on Castle Point and refers to it as Castle Point, and yet all of our understanding of the fort is that it wasn't built until at least the 1780s or maybe the 1790s. So it's possible that's a much earlier structure as well up there than our current understanding of it is, and the two are almost certainly linked together in some way. And finally then on to the sort of the last part really, which is to think about shipwrecks. The image on the screen here is a site at the southern end of Kenfig and Margam Sands. It's not known what it is. We know where it is because we can see it on the beach, and we have aerial photographs of it again, but it's an unnamed wreck, possibly the remains of a Dutch East Indiaman, but that's not certain. And this status of this vessel as being an unnamed vessel is something that is true for many of the dots on the map. Lots of the offshore ones have been subject to really, really innovative work by Bangor University, which is going to become published and available in September, I think, which is going to sort of assign very, very confident identifications to around 200 currently unnamed vessels, which in turn will unlock the potential to name more and understand what more of them are. But there's a lot of them that we don't know the names of. And there's many more that we don't know where they are. So all of the circles, the clear circles on this map, represent documented losses of ships. And some of them have multiple losses because we don't know where they're lost. So we just have to go, well, we've got 30 records of a ship lost off Anglesey. So the only way to really deal with those is to have a single point off Anglesey. I don't know, where do you put it? Anywhere around here. And assign those 30 vessels to it until you can begin to maybe find the remains of one of them on the seabed and take that individual record and give it a geographic location. The Royal Commission is not the primary source for shipwreck data either within the UK or within Wales. That job lies with the UK Hydrographic Office, who continually have a rolling programme of going out, the Civil Hydrography Programme, to map the seabed for navigational purposes. So they are finding new wrecks. Survey methods are improving. I think the last time Cardigan Bay was done was possibly when people were either using just a single sort of ping of sound or a lump of lead on the end of a piece of rope. Whereas some of these areas have been done using what we call swap bathymetry, which produces a really detailed, almost like a not quite a photograph, that's the wrong word, but a really, really detailed topography map of the seabed with a sort of a resolution of around 1 to 2 meters. So there's great discrepancies between the level of survey in different places, which in turn means we have different levels of understanding of what's there. And there's a sort of an ongoing task to update our wreck records with the data that the UKIHO are turning up. And as they then refine their records to correlate our records with those records, and eventually all the dots on this map will be green. That's a, maybe sometime in about 2040, we'll reach that point that the yellow dots and the blue dots will all be in exact correlation and all of the circles will be filled in, and the fine spots in the crosses will be sort of confirmed as things, and we can sort of have one data set. Realistically, it's probably an impossibility to achieve that, but we have to try. So back to Fishguard, or in this case, Goodick, another of Toby's aerial photos in a remarkably joined up piece of field work. I was on the beach at Goodick while Toby was flying overhead back in early March. Now, if you remember back to that Lewis Morris chart and that fish weir, this is the fish weir that is located on his chart. So again, this is some at least 300 years old in terms of its method, that literally was to catch fish as they swam out down the side of the bay on the falling tide. They would become lodged in here, which probably had a series of posts and either nets or wattle work on them. The day we were down there doing work, actually, there was a big dogfish in some distress that had got itself lodged at one end that we had to kind of hook out by its tail and put into one of the channels to wait for the tide to come back in. But there's several wrecks on this beach. There's one just down here that is a new one that was located, again, through looking back through some of the aerial survey material, I think in that case to look at some photos of the fish weir and actually to spot some frame tops that were sticking out of the sand. And there's another more well-documented vessel over here. But then there's lots of other things on the beach. There's walls in here. There's a big metal thing here, which is not a shipwreck, but is the remains of an old lobster keep pot. We have sort of historical sources talking about vessels being lost and certainly beached deliberately in this area, from Richard Fenton in his tour of Pembrokeshire in 1811, who remarks and waxes lyrical about the beauty of Fishguard Bay, and it is a stunning location, but also that it's vulnerable to winds from the north and the east. But when that does happen, people can just run for the beach in the knowledge that there's a big expanse of beach without too much wave action that they can then beach their ships on to preserve the crew and the cargo. He doesn't make any mention of the ships, and that the archaeological evidence suggests that there's possibly quite a few on this beach. One of them is, as I've said, well known. It was discovered in 2012 when it started to become exposed. It's very, very flat. this beach, and the shipwreck material is also very, very flat, or at least the material sticking out of the sand doesn't stick up very far. So you arrive on the beach, you look at your jar, I'm in the right place, looking at the GPS, and this is what you see before you. Two ranging rods marking either end of the vessel. You can see a few things sticking up here, maybe something over here. It's very, very difficult to pick out what is there. So again, the technology that we now have available to just put up a small small drone to 10 meters or so allows us to be able to see things in these kind of dimensions, as well as helping us map the site effectively. And what we can see really clearly is the outline of a ship, a series of posts that look like they're down the center on the keel, but I think actually what's happened with this vessel is it's sort of tipped right over on its side. There's some really lovely historical photos from North Wales showing ships in that kind of pose after they've become wrecked. So these are quite possibly the beams along the center of the ship, and then there's quite an angular feature in the what I'm going to assume is the keel of the vessel here. And the way the planks at this end are cut, with the they've got quite diagonal shapes to them, which is where they sort of fit into the posts, either the bow or the stern of the ship. Then further over here by the fisher, we have the same kind of arrangement of a vessel that we were able to identify from the aerial photographs, go and sort of physically ground truth and ascertain that there was something there, and add that to the National Monuments record. Shortly after which, remember, the public who'd been down there and noted it for the first time got in touch with us and updated us with a few more photos. One of the things we've been doing on this beach is geophysical survey, which is not something that is commonly done in the intertidal zone. It's really, really common on archaeological sites on the land and in the offshore zone, ship mounted and ROV mounted, so remote operated vehicle mounted things. And you will see it on frequently on Time Team and similar programs. So we've been sort of trialing it a bit tentatively in the intertidal zone, particularly a magnetometer survey, to see if it is any good in sandy, wet environments. We chose Goodick because we know there's a shipwreck there. We can see it, we can run the geophysics over it, and we can see what it picks up. We've done it on a few other beaches where we also know the shipwrecks, but we don't actually know where they are because they're completely buried and we didn't have good positions. But this is one where we can really test things. And you get this big black mark on the plot, which corresponds to this vessel. But there's also loads of other things around here. These really, really hard returns are probably big metal things. These are possibly, I think these might be old mooring footings, like commonly people used to use a tractor tire or something like that filled with concrete. Maybe they might relate to those. But there's lots of other stuff, and none of this is visible. These three plots, the 60 meters or so, sort of is in this area. So it doesn't extend this far. It doesn't include this big metal object. But there's plenty of things that are within the sand there. So quite feasibly, we could geophysics the whole of this beach to begin to understand where there is archaeology and where there isn't archaeology. And where there is nothing, certainly down to a meter and a half or so, is quite clear. And on that note, I should say that this vessel, we can see the outline of it. And we've also done a little bit of probing across here. And in the center of the site, there's a good meter of sand before you get back to timber. So if you imagine that in cross-section, there's actually a lot of a hull of a ship embedded in the sand down here. And then the last site I'm going to talk to you, to avoid being in massive danger of overrunning and cutting into everyone's evenings, is a site called the Albion, which is a paddle steamer site that was lost in, the ship was lost in 1837. And it's one of the main sites for the Cherish project, one of the main shipwreck sites in the intertidal zone that the project has been monitoring, again, to understand how it changes over time, how it's impacted by coastal processes, and to sort of think about ways to monitor it and manage it and interpret it and so on. So the Albion was built in Bristol in 1831, and it's built at a time, it's a paddle steamer. This is a model of it that's in the Science Museum in London, which gives us a wonderful appreciation. It's a fairly contemporary model as well, of what the vessel looked like. But it's a type of technology that was fairly short-lived in, medium to longer distance vessels. So it was superseded by the screw propeller eventually, in the middle of the 19th century, which was more efficient at driving ships forward. Paddle wheels were maintained and kept in places like the Great Rivers of North America, where they had an advantage in working in shallow water and quite flat bottom things, and also in British vessels as tugboats, actually, right to the end of the 19th century, because they were really, really maneuverable in being able to run the paddles, you know, in opposite directions. But these ones in the 1830s are, you know, the technological peak of their day. And they were used on routes, in this case, the Albion on the Dublin to Bristol sort of mail route. So carrying the post, passengers, and then a deck cargo of pigs, actually, because the Albion with its paddle propulsion and steam propulsion had the ability to fit to a timetable that a sailing vessel couldn't do. And it had the ability to transport fresh things like pigs in much, much better condition and therefore fetch a much better price than if they were coming on a sailing ship. And there's a whole series of these vessels that were operated by the Bristol Steam Packet. And as I've said, at the time, they're the absolute, you know, these are the jet planes of their day, if you like. And there's a whole series of them lost along the south coast of Wales and another one off Cork. Starting with the Frolic in 1831 off Nash Point, which was totally, you know, smashed to pieces and destroyed. The Albion in 1837, the City of Bristol up in Ross City Bay, and then the Queen, which is in much, much deeper water between Skokholm and Skoma off the coast of Pembrokeshire. If you would like to read more on these, this book is brilliant. It's absolutely fascinating. It sticks exactly to its title, Early Bristol Paddle Steamer Shipwrecks, and describes the historical events behind those four vessels and the Killarney, which is lost off Cork. So the Albion, meanwhile, is tasked with sailing from Dublin to Bristol in April 1837 under the command of somebody called George Bailey, who was a really, really experienced captain of these kind of steamships. He was also quite keen on a fast passage and to be able to, if not equal the record, certainly keep to the timetable and the fast passage that he promised his crew. So we often think of, you know, taking a ship from Dublin to Bristol around the coast of Pembrokeshire with all the hazards off St. David's Head, Grassome, the Smalls, Skoma, that you might just, you know, skirt the outside of it, go around everything and be on your way up the Bristol Channel. George Bailey had other ideas and decided to take a, let's call it not a shortcut, the most direct route is probably the way to describe it, which led him through a narrow stretch of very, very tidal water between Skoma Island and the mainland, the Deer Park, which is this stretch of water here called Jack Sound. And you can see a few of the natural hazards sticking out of it. And doing this, although it doesn't seem like much, it may have saved him, you know, 30 minutes here or there across the whole length of his voyage. Sadly for him and the ship, he caught the vessel on these stones here, the crab stones going through Jacksound. He later claimed that it was in order to avoid a rowing boat that had mysteriously appeared, although no other accounts on the ship of the passengers recalled seeing a rowing boat. But Bailey was believed, and that was the, you know, the exoneration in the inquest afterwards as to why he lost the ship. The Albion was hulled and was taking on water and basically proceeded down here. He was hoping to be able to get into Milford Haven because the engines were still running, so he still had propulsion. But it soon became evident that the ship wasn't going to make it, and he beached it, or aimed for the beach here in Gateholm Bay. The settlement on Gateholm itself is probably a, you know, the content of a whole other lecture, but which we won't go into today. But Bailey was probably aiming for this small stretch of sand here. He missed, sadly, and put the ship here onto these rocks, which caused it to sort of slew around and break up over the next days and weeks. What it did manage to do, though, because his sort of calmness and sharp thinking got the ship onto the beach, many of the passengers were rescued by a sailing ship that was actually sort of going past and stood by. The mail was got off. Lots of the, let's just say, many of the pigs survived. Many of the pigs did not survive, but the people in Marlow's had plenty of bacon and everything for the the foreseeable future. And the ship and the wreck site looks like this. And much of the time when you go down there, you see a huge expanse of sand and a few pieces of machinery sticking up. And I think for many years, what was thought to exist of the Albion was just this thing here sticking up, which is one of the crank arms of the paddle wheel. So this end was connected to the engine, and then down here under the sand is the frame of one of these paddle wheels. A few other things sticking up. So this is 2017, Cherish monitoring from the air. Think back to that toolkit, big flat expanse of beach. This is in 2021 when there's some quite big things becoming exposed. This is one of the sort of frames for holding that crank arm, and a few other things in the background. And going down there in this case with a really high precision GPS, being able to start to map all of these things together, and then really with the aid of local resident of Marlowe's, Chris Jessop, who is the definite expert on the site and who has this intimate knowledge of the beach because he visits it on a regular basis and understands the tidal regime, the sediment regime, where things are, also has a deep love of the site and of side lever steam engine, so knows what all of these things are, where they fit together, where they fit in the ship, and what that means for the distribution of material. And you can see, for example, the relationship between the paddle wheels, which are very much in the middle of the ship, and the location of the boiler, funnel, and so on, which are a little way further aft. Talking to Chris earlier this year, he was like, oh, there's been a big movement of sand. We should go down, have a look. There's timbers exposed, which nobody thought was visible on the site. And you can immediately see that all of that big expanse of sand has been scoured out. And there's a huge swimming pool, basically, in the center of the site, which is really, really difficult to see through, standing at eye level. Again, fortunately, we can take to the air with a small drone and begin to get, for the first time, because the site was so exposed, a real understanding of much more of the extent of the material. So bearing things, piston, valves, there's another one of these over here, which is usually exposed, part of the boiler, one of the condensers, and these really, really big timbers in the middle of the site. And more timbers had been visible the week before, before I was able to get down there. So we're able to, by having that link to people who understand the site on the ground in a really, really intrinsic way, we're able to react when things appear and document things in a much better way. And we can now very firmly say that there's an awful lot more of this ship there than perhaps people thought. We can begin to understand that most of the machinery is this side of where the paddle wheels are. So the stern of the vessel is probably at this end, the left-hand end of your screen. The ship had hit the beach and sort of slewed around and ended up with its bow pointing out to sea, and begin to put detail into our understanding of this quite important site that we didn't have from some of the historical material and we didn't have previously. So thinking a bit more broadly then, as I kind of try and finish things up, that hopefully gives you a bit of an insight into the sort of the breadth and the type and the nature and the richness of the maritime archaeology around Wales. But I should also say that it is a resource, if we want to look at it that way, a wonderful resource that is very fragile and very finite in nature. We're always finding new things and making new discoveries, but it is not infinite in terms of what is there. And it's something that is increasingly threatened by climate change and the coastal change that is associated with that, and the natural coastal change that occurs. Sea level rise, storminess, coastal erosion, geomorphological changes, warming seawater, bringing in new biological things that, for example, like to eat wood, or slightly more acid oceans, which degrade iron shipwrecks faster, and so on. We have things happening which are a reaction to the climate change that the Cherish project is looking at. Offshore renewable energy is a critical thing for mitigating the effects of climate change, but it also has an impact on our maritime heritage and indeed the natural heritage there. Coastal development, which is a more reactive thing against storminess and flooding and whatever, also has a big impact on the intertidal zone. So these are big challenges to our ability to manage and conserve and protect this really wonderful cultural heritage for today. Never mind the people who are coming along in the future. My children are probably shouting a bit in the background and you can hear them. I'd love it for them to be able to go out and, you know, these sites to be available and be protected for them to look at and understand and enjoy. And then we get to the kind of the catch 22 of everything, that stuff being exposed like this. On the one hand, you think, oh no, that site's exposed. It is inevitably going to be degraded, particularly the fragile things like the submerged forest. But it also offers us this opportunity to be able to investigate it, to sample it, to understand it, to record it, and to be able to tell a better story, effectively, and a more detailed story about what is there, which in terms means means that the wider public is able to appreciate their cultural heritage more, and perhaps, you know, be more invested in looking after it and caring for it and so on. So you end up in a, you know, something of a circle, which is where you all come in, very much so, that you're all here and have, you know, voluntarily come along to a talk to listen to me ramble for an hour about maritime archaeology and the Royal Commission. And there are things that, you know, people can do because they're interested in it. You can join the Nautical Archaeology Society, attend some of their training. I think I saw Ian Cundy's name somewhere in the participant list, who has run the brilliant Welsh Ret Research Project, which has, you know, put huge detail into our knowledge of many of those documented losses of wrecks. Another thing I have to do is to go through the 200 odd reports that project has generated. The Glamorgan Gwent Archaeological Trust's Alfredia project is running again to take volunteers out into the intertidal zone to help map things. You can discover it for yourself as well. The National Monuments Record of Wales is free and available and accessible online. Web addresses to follow, if you can't jot them down now, or photograph the screen through the follow-up email. And also through something called the Wales Coast Explorer phone app, which will introduce you to natural heritage around the Welsh coast, but also to the cultural heritage, the archaeology, the shipwrecks, the submerged landscapes. There's around 70 sites in there at the moment, to sort of with some information and links to visit them, but also a facility to report when you see something. Just take a photo, press a button, and it should, you know, find its way to hopefully me eventually. But really, if you don't want to do any of those things, if you spend time at the coast, walk along a regular stretch of coast, and you begin to see things changing, or see things that you've not seen before, or know of a site that is becoming degraded or buried, and it could be above the high water mark, please get in touch. I'm always, you know, very happy to receive inquiries about things, and to say that things are becoming exposed, because we, with the best will in the world, cannot cover the whole coast on a regular basis in the way that, you know, we would like to. There would have to be hundreds of me. What a thought that would be. But there are hundreds of you, 142 of you, in fact, which is more than enough to be able to go out and report on these things when they come up, basically. So that's my kind of closing thing, is that with this wonderful maritime archaeology around the coast of Wales that I've been lucky enough to, you know, enjoy growing up and now work on for a living. But there is huge scope for, you know, better information about it and better protection of it. I think I'll stop at that point because I've hit an hour.
Talking about Julian, I'm scorched the door down. Thanks very much, Julian, for that really, really fascinating talk. I'm certainly glad you took the hour to go right through all that information. Very, very interesting, all of it was. Hoffin diolch'n fawr I chi am ymuno â ni heno, I staff y Comisiwn am drefnu, ac yn olaf, diolch'n fawr iawn I chi, Julian, am sgwrs y ddiddorol iawn. Just finally then, thank you all for joining us tonight. Thanks to all the Comisiwn staff who have been involved with the arrangements. And of course, thank you very much to Julian for a very fascinating talk. Nos da.